Montes electromechanics. This is a theory that we published with Otto Wolf in 2004, and the idea was to understand the role of defects on nanotubes, but using an analytical approach, not the molecular dynamics simulation, nor experiments, because you have not the control of the defects in the experiments, but just with theory. And Rodrigo show us these kind of experiments, really fascinating, but you remember that the maximal strength that he measured was not close to the ideal material strength, but calculated according, for example, to density functional theory. So probably there were some defects in the nanotubes. So the idea starts was just to, I'm just going to comment about this paper, I would like to try to understand which was the role of the defects in the experiment that Rondo Ruoff carried out at Northwestern University in 2000. And the first question is, can we use a Griffith theory? You know that the classical theory in fracture mechanics, this is the most powerful theory that we have in order to predict the strength of solids, is a classical inelastic fracture mechanics. And basically the theory is based on an energy balance during crack growth. But the main hypothesis is that there is a continuous crack growth during failure. And in a nanotube, perhaps you have a kind of quantized fracture. So this was the first question. Another very powerful theory that we use in order to predict the strength of solids, but in a deterministic sense, is the Bayesian statistics. And also, Bayesian statistics assume that defects are proportional to the volume of the structure. In four nanotubes, perhaps this is not bad, for nanotubes or for objects at the nanoscale. So I would like to recall you just some very fundamental concept. I think that most of you know this concept, but let me summarize in one slide. If you have a linear elastic plate and you have a node here and you apply a far field, you have a stress concentration here near this point, that is 3. So this means that the stress here is 3 times higher than the far field stress. And of course this has a huge implication in the failure of the defective plate. If you have an elliptical hole, the stress concentration is given by 1 plus 2a over b, where a and b are the half axis of the elliptical hole. So you can imagine that when you consider a crack, this stress concentration tends to infinity, and you have what we call a stress intensification. And of course, if we assume that the failure of the structure will take place when the maximum stress will reach the material strength, of course we have some paradox, because you have to admit that a structure with defect has a negligible strength. And this was the reason why Griffith proposed his energy-based theory. And of course, this is not the only problem that we have, because if we have a structure with an elliptical hole, probably the results are not correct in any case, because here are completely wrong. So in the transition, of course, they are not correct. So we have to invent something else. This is just what they mentioned now. So another strange thing is that if you consider this simple approach in order to derive the strength of the structure, you have to admit that a small hole or a big hole has the same effects on the fracture strength of the structure, because the elasticity is a continuum theory, so there is not a characteristic length inside elasticity, and an hole is an hole, it's not a big hole or a small hole, it's an hole. So you have not the size effects, and this of course is something strange, because I would expect that a small hole has not a big influence on the strength, but a large hole must have a larger influence. So this is something that cannot predict according to a continuum-based theory. And of course, elasticity is a continuum grid theory. So Griffith proposed this energy balance. Basically, in this slide there is all the fracture mechanics that has been developed, because we have it's very simple approach, but fracture mechanics is all in this slide. All the fracture mechanics in this slide. So the idea is very simple. You have during crack growth the variation of the sum of the total potential energy plus the energy dissipated during crack growth in order to break the surface must be equal to zero. The variation must be equal to zero. So you can also mention that define this the opposite of the variation of the total potential energy with respect to the crack surface as the energy release rate. So in this case, if you define the fracture energy, usually we say fracture energy, but we are referring to fracture energy per unit area. If you define the fracture energy per unit area as the total energy divided by the area, you see that the crack propagation, according to Griffith, will take place when the energy release rate will be equal to this critical value. So it's not a stress-based theory, it's an energy-based. And also, you can also try to understand which is the stability of the crack propagation. This is another important aspect. And the results, if you apply this concept to the infinite plane with a crack, you get this result for the strength of the material. You see here you have the fracture energy, the Young modulus, and the half crack length. So in this case, we have not a strength that is close to zero, and this is good. But on the other hand, you see that we have a strength that tends to infinity if we assume that the crack length tends to zero. And this is something that, of course, has not meaning, because you have, in some peculiar case, you have materials or structure defect-free. So, for example, nanotube can be defect-free, but the strength, the ideal strength, is fine. So, we proposed this simple modification. It's very simple. From a mathematical point of view, you have just substitute the differential with the finite difference. That's it. This basically corresponds to remove, not to add. So this theory is becoming very, very powerful, I think. We published a lot of extension in other contexts. We have removed basically the hypothesis of the continuous crack growth. And removing this hypothesis, mathematically, is very simple. You can apply the theory in a very simple way. I will show you perhaps an example. And also the prediction for the stability of the crack propagation change. And you can imagine that with this theory, you have prediction that with respect to inelastic fracture mechanics, in some cases, diverge. So we have completely different results. And another important aspect that you are introducing basically a characteristic length in the theory. Because if you are assuming that there is a quantizing fracture crack propagation, basically you are introducing characteristic length. And this characteristic length is able to give you to allow you to treat the size effects. For example, an hole is a big hole or is a small hole if the radius is small or large compared to the fracture quantum. And you will see that the results are much more convincing. So this, for example, is the application of this theory for a crack. Now this, you can imagine this row tending to zero. This is the crack, the radius of the crack tip. You can also consider this tending to zero. But what is important is that if you apply this theory, you see there is a deviation with respect to the classical approach, that is when Q fracture quantum tend to zero. Okay? But if there is a fracture quantum not negligible, you see that you have a variation. In particular, when the crack length tends to zero, you have a finite value for the material defect-free strength. And I don't want to spend too much I can also derive this equation just to show you one example of application of the theory, because it's very simple. You know that we have a stress, so-called stress intensity factor n books, are thick books in which you can find the solution for the stress intensity, for the stress intensity factor corresponding to a given structure, a given geometry, a given applied load. So for example, for the Griffith plane, that is the simplest structure, for this case, if you find in that stress intensity factor n, you will see that the result of the stress intensity factor is simply given by this applied stress multiplied by the square root of pi multiplied by the half crack length. So this is something that is quite difficult to derive this result. And there are, and this is the simplest case, but we are lucky. As I told you, that there is a book in which you have already all these results. So applying fracture mechanics is very, very simple. If you want to apply fracture mechanics, you just to put K1 equal to the fracture toughness of the material. This is exactly what I've shown you before, because there is a correlation between this approach that I mentioned in my previous slide and this, because there is a correlation between the energy release rate and the stress intensity factor that is given by this equation, where E is the Young modulus. Okay, if you consider this, or this is the same. So now, if you apply inelastic fracture mechanics for this case, you have to consider this equality, and the result for the fracture strength is given by this equation. That is the classical equation in fracture mechanics. If I plot this equation here, you have, of course, this behavior, and here you have this this. In the limit of A tending to zero, you have the limit. So if you want to apply quantized fracture mechanics, so you just one example, but I think that is important. What you have to do is very simple. You have to consider not the stress intensity factor, but its quantized version. If you the results of substituting the differential with the final difference is this condition for the crack propagation. Not the stress intensity factor must be equal to the fracture toughness of the material, but the square root of the mean value of the squared. That's it. So basically you have to make just one inference. Very, very simple. If you have if you want to calculate this quantized version, you have just to calculate the mean value between the A and A plus Q, where Q is the fracture quantum. And then you take the classical solution, you have the solution for the stress intensity factor, it is a solution of the crack length. You make the integral and you take the square root of this. Okay? Very, very simple. You make this calculation and then you put this equal to the fracture toughness of the material. If you make this, you derive this equation with rho tending to zero, with rho equal to zero. Okay? And also, in this case, the prediction for the crack propagation is you can see that the process is unstable. But there are, of course, other cases in which the process are stable. Let me show you an example. The fact that the process is unstable, you can see from this diagram. When the crack increases the length, the failure strength is decreased. So this means that it's unstable. So if we consider, for example, a crack here in this plate, okay, basically this is the Griffith plate. If I consider this, and you apply the load, it's impossible for me to stop the crack propagation. I try, but it's impossible. The crack propagation is unstable. But of course, if you consider a different scheme, for example, if you consider a force directly applied to the crack, this is a completely different story. A completely different story. Why? Okay, experimentally it's very simple. So you have to apply the force here, the crash propagation is very, very stable. In fact, if you look at the stress intensity factor angle for this case, you will see that the stress intensity factor will be given by the force per unit width divided by the square root of pi times a. Okay? And you see that in all the critical force for fracture propagation will be given by this formula. Okay, so you have to increase the force if you want to increase the crack propagation. So in this case, this process is stable. And if you apply, for example, quantized fracture mechanics to this scheme, you have some new solution. For example, you can understand which is the role of the discrete nature of the material due for the crack propagation. So I have to, let me show you also this example. We have just received very positive referees comment from Nature discussing exactly this very, very simple comment. Very, very simple. That is this. If you take this value is, as I told you, you have to apply this concept. So you have to make the integral of this quantity, something like that. Okay? Then you pay the square. It is quite an obvious integral. But you see, it appears the fracture quantum. You can understand which is the role of the discrete nature of the matter during the crack propagation. So this is you can make you can assume that Q is small with respect to the crack length, just to have an idea about the role of Q. So this is 1 plus Q over A, and is F. Plus something. Okay. If you consider the first term corresponds basically to inelastic fracture mechanics. You see, the result of K1 star is equal to K1. But if you consider this second term, you have a different prediction. And in particular, if you want to spend 1 minute more, you could say that this is equal to F divided by the square root of pi, then this is, or pi A, this is the classical result. And then you have the square root of 1 minus U over A, A here, so Q like this, right, something like that. But the denominator, yes. If you see some mistakes, please tell me. Perhaps was the denominator, please. No. So basically, the prediction, you see, the prediction of the critical force is increased by the presence of the discrete nature of the matter, because you see, this basically is the equivalent fracture toughness of the material. If you make this equality, you see that you have the predicted force is larger than the respective case of Q tending to zero. And this perhaps is the reason why we have the web, spider web with a discrete nature. So if we are making some molecular dynamic simulation by changing the size of this element, for example. Okay, and if you increase the size, and you are considering an insect trapped by the web, you have a more larger damaged zone according to what this equation predicts, for example. And also you can also make other calculations, for example, considering the nonlinear materials and so on, but in a very simple way. You see, this equation are very simple, but there is a mistake probably, but the idea is very simple. So using the prediction of quantized structural mechanics for the Griffith plate, we can try to understand which is the role of defects in nanotubes. So in particular, you see, we considered in this case a small crack with LF n equal to 2, in the sense that we have removed two chemical bonds. Okay, and then we have increased the length of the crack, so n equal to 4 is a larger crack, etc. Okay, and these are the prediction of quantized structural mechanics compared with the prediction of the molecular mechanics simulation. You see, you have to spend a lot of time to make prediction according to molecular mechanics or molecular dynamics, etc. But in this case, basically, you can derive this number in 1 minute. 1 minute, 1 minute, 1 minute, 1 minute. Very, very, very simple. And also, in this case, I will consider as a fracture quantum just this distance. So something that is absolutely reasonable. Not just, I do not consider fracture quantum as a specific parameter, but just as the distance between the edges and chemical bonds. So the result is this. In this comparison, there is just one specific parameter that is the equivalent radius at the tip of this crack. You see, I don't know which is in reality the equivalent radius at the tip of the crack. It's something that we have to invent in a certain sense. But this is the result for this comparison. It's something that is plausible. It's 0.8 Q. Q is this. So it's 0.8 Q. Something reasonable. And also, you have to take into account the linear elastic fracture mechanics that can make prediction only you considering long, sharp crack. This is the only thing that linear elastic fracture mechanics can take into account. Long, sharp crack. In this case, you can also consider short cracks, defects with any sharp size and shape. So we can apply, for example, also to walls. And this is what is reported in this table. You have here, you have the failure stress divided by the ideal material strength, the defect-free strength, and considering different holes with different size. M equal to 1 corresponds to the removal of 6 carbon atoms here. N equal to 2 corresponds to the removal of the adjacent perimeter of the carbon atoms, and so on. And so you are increasing the size in this direction. So you see that the prediction is not one third, as I have mentioned at the beginning, according to elasticity, but it's something that is close, is tending to one third. You see, this value is close to one third, but it's not exactly one third. For this case, for example, it's a completely different value. But it's important to understand that also, if you remove just one atom, if you have just one legacy, the strength is reduced by a factor of 20%. That is huge. That is huge. So, in some cases, materials are very sensitive to flow at the nanoscale, very sensitive. And of course, we can try to apply this concept to the experiments performed by Ruoff. There is no big problem in fitting the results. For example, the highest value was 63 gigapascal, you remember. And if you assume M equal to 1 whole, now you have 64 gigapascal. Of course, I don't know if this is the is the correct scenario, but it's plausible. You can fit, and then you have no problem in fitting the smallest value, because basically you are approaching to a continuum, so there is no problem in fitting value. And this suggests also that we can have a kind of quantization in the strength, because if you just consider one vacancy, you have a jump, a big jump, 20%, etc. And then, of course, we are working here in this zone. But on the other hand, I think that we can observe this kind of quantization. In fact, we try to rationalize a few experiments in which perhaps we were able to observe the ideal material strength. And you see that there were jumps. In the experiments, you cannot have a value, for example, 100 gigapascal and then 98. No, this never happened. You have 100 and then something very, very much more smaller, like 80, something like that. But not just only in nanotubes, but also in the silicon carbide nanowires, etc. This approach is something that can be extended. Can be extended also in dynamics. You have to consider here not just a quantization in the space, let's say, but also in time. And also in this case, you can predict some strange behavior. For example, this is a classical behavior of the apparent value of the fracture toughness as a function of the time to failure. If you reduce the time to failure, usually the strength of the material will increase. But of course, the strength of the material has to be a constant. If the theory is very good, if the theory is good, the strength must be a constant. Is the approach that you are using that have to give you this behavior. We cannot admit that the strength of the material is a function of the time to failure. Otherwise, it's not the strength. And this is exactly what we are forced to admit with the classical fracture mechanics. But if you use one-less fracture mechanics, you get exactly this behavior without assuming that the material strength is a function of something strange things, time to failure or crack length. Because you see, what fracture mechanics has recognized that we have some problem here. So he invented the R-car behavior. So the fracture toughness is a function of the crack length. But this is without sense. Understand? So this is the extension of dynamic fracture mechanics. We also extended this theory, for example, for fatigue crack growth. We have other paper, but also about now, I mentioned Vibrio statistics, and we also make some modification of the Vibrio statistics in order to predict the strength of the material. And in particular, Vibrio statistics, the simplest version of Vibrio statistics given by this equation. And you see that in this equation, you have basically the probability of failure of a fiber under a given stress here. You have these two parameters here, the Vibrio modulus, and this is another parameter that is related to the mean value of the stress distribution. And usually here, you have the volume of the fiber. So this is why you are able to derive size effects according to Vibrio statistics, because it basically Vibrio assumes that the larger the volume, the larger the probability of finding defects in the volume, and so the smaller the strength. At the nanoscale, on the microscale, you can also insert instead of the volume the surface. If you're assuming that basically the predominant defects are on the surface, like steps, something like this. You can put here the surface, but in a nanotube, by the way, surface and volume in a single wall nanotubes are the same, because you have just one atomic layer. You can also have, probably, just field effects, without any correlation between the volume or the surface. So we try to make some interpretation, make an interpretation of the experiments by Ruoff according to this idea. And you see here the results. So this is the classical Vibrio statistic that in this strange diagram has to appear as a straight line. Okay? So this is the correlation according to classical value statistics. But if you basically consider a simple modification, that is a classical value statistic but without correlation with the volume, you get these results. So each of these points basically are experiments performed by Wolf, and the theory is just a straight line. So again, I think that in those nanotubes there were some defects. The material is very sensitive to defects, but not there were not a huge amount of defects, just a few defects. Because otherwise, the statistics would be better than this. And according to quantized structure mechanics, you can have some ideas about the size of the larger defect, because the larger defect is the predominant one. But applying this probabilistic approach, you can have also an idea about the number of defects. Okay, this is my last piece. If you have any question. Q is of the order of the kilometer. And to have an idea about Q is very simple. You have to imagine that no, you can stay there. You have to imagine that the force, the stress, the fracture stress is given by this quantity. Okay? So if you consider the defect-free value for the strength, you have this equality. Okay, so this implies that Q, you expect Q of the order of 2 over pi K1C squared divided by sigma U squared. Okay? So, for example, if you want to make some, apply this theory to a given material, and you have an idea about the fracture toughness of material, and the defect-free, what is defect-free, I don't know, but macroscopic strength of the material, okay, like this, if you take this, you have a macroscopic strength, it is not really a defect-free strength, but, okay? Then if you start to put some macroscopic crack, you can apply the theory, but you have to use this value. And if you derive the fracture quantum for this case, for example, you will have 1 millimeter, something like that. There is a theoretical way to understand exactly the value of Q, but so we publish a paper on this, but but it's quite complex, so I don't think that I don't want to discuss this now. So we have a paper on this, but you are forced to use the numerical simulation and so on. So basically the idea is if you want to derive the fracture quantum, you have to assume simultaneously an energy failure and a stress failure. And if you consider both these equation, you can derive the fracture quantum.
And how can this method take into account the media? The solution of
The media in which sense?
The water is the air inside the nanotubes, inside the defects of nanotubes. Can you take it away?
Please repeat the question.
Can this method take into account the media of the
media you see, the air, for example?
Yeah, if this is in air or water or in this solution.
If you want to consider something under pressure, you're saying something under pressure, for example?
No, that's the. If you are.
No,
if you have a defect, you can put. You can have molecular of water or air inside.
Ah, okay, in this sense. No, of course, no. You can imagine that the fracture energy or something like that will be affected a little bit. But you cannot study the details. The details is a continuum theory, so it's a quasi-continuum theory, so you cannot understand which is the role of hydrogen with respect to another element, something you cannot. But of course, if you want to understand, for example, which is the strength of a nanotube under pressure, something like that, you can do this, because you got in the stress, you take the stress intensity factor handbooks. There is a stress intensity factor as a function of the pressure in a tube, for example. You apply the theory, you get the result.
And I have another question.
Please.
More general. Because I have heard in this course that they use a lot content that they are related to continuum media, continuum mechanics.
Mm-hmm.
And this is not continuum mechanics. Do you think that this needs another formulation that not use stress and pressure, but this is concept of continuum mechanics. Do you think it's needed another formulation?
But this theory is based on continuum.
But the thing is not a continuum.
It's a quasi-continuum theory, basically. Most similar to a continuum theory, to a molecular dynamic simulation, for example. So I think it's something between a classical theory of elasticity and molecular dynamic simulation. And in fact, with this theory, you can fit very well numerical the results from the molecular dynamic simulation, because something is in between. So I think that every method has some domain, you see. So this is something in between a continuum and atomistic view. The atomic size, and of course this is completely, you cannot assume these at the macro scale. So is what is a reality Q is not 100% clear. I think that is related to the step back energy release during step back during crack propagation. So see, it's a kind of size scale related to the energy release in the material. But in any case, this equation is correct. So if basically Q is something that allows you to make an asymptotic matching between stress failure and energy failure of an elastic fracture mechanics. So you have basically an asymptotic matching. And the same for fatigue, for example. You have an asymptotic matching between dealer and buyers. Short crack behavior, long crack behavior. If you apply this theory in fatigue, you have this asymptotic matching, thanks to you.
So in the simulation, if you change the boundary condition, you have to change also the value of Q?
No. In some case, in general, I think that you can see an effect of the boundary condition Q, but we have never seen. So when you fit the molecular dynamics simulation, you get very good results without any problem related to the boundary condition. Perhaps there are some problems with the boundary condition in the simulation, but this is another story. Okay, so let us make a second. It is very, I think it is very related to this. Because basically it's something related to the strength of nanotube bubble, not just to single nanotubes, but to nanotube bubble. And basically I'm going to describe very briefly this paper that has been inspired by this tunneling electron microscope image. See, this is a very fantastic image from Cambridge University.
Can you not?
Sorry?
Can you not explain this?
Ah, sorry. And you see that basically here you have a bubble in which you have nanotubes, but some of the nanotubes are collapsed without any external pressure. Why? So this is something not strange, but perhaps it's not. Perhaps this is important because it could have some implication on the strength of the material, of the band. And in particular, the idea is this, very very simple. You know that. If you have a shell under pressure, you can have buckling, okay? And the equation in order to derive the critical pressure for buckling is this one, in which this term is basically the bending stiffness of the structure, okay? I have divided the bending stiffness in these two terms because this is this equation is the bending stiffness of graphene. And n is the number of layer of the nanotube. There is an exponent here. In theory, this exponent has to be 3 if you have a compact cross-section, because in the bending stiffness, there is the thickness rise to exponent 3. So this means that if the wall are basically, if not wall, but you have a compact cross-section, there is full interaction between the wall, you expect this exponent equal to 3. But if the wall are independent, because we have weak interaction between them, you expect this exponent to be 1. So this is the reason why I used in the numbers that that I'm going to show you the intermediate value of alpha equal to 2. But then this value just at the macro scale, because when you are considering a nanotube bundle, you have a pressure due to the self-interaction between nanotubes. And if you could treat this, you can imagine that the bundle is a liquid-like material. When you have a fluid, and you consider, now, I think that we have discussed this in the previous lecture, especially in person discussed this, but if you have a fluid and you have a small hole here, the pressure inside, the pressure is a function of the radius of curvature and is given by gamma over R, if R is the radius and gamma is the surface tension of the fluid. So in the bundle, there is something similar. Of course, you have the surface adhesion energy, not the surface tension. But you expect a term like this, that for small object, in particular for nanotubes, become important. So the equation that you have to use is this one, in which you have also this term, okay? That basically corresponds to increasing the applied force. So if you use the previous simple equation and you try to fit the results according to molecular dynamic simulation, again from the Cambridge, okay, from a group in Cambridge, you see that there is quite a good correlation. So even the equation is very simple, it is very simple, this is basically what they have observed. But the most important aspect, I think, is that the equation shows you that you can have cell collapse under zero external pressure. Because if you put the critical value close to zero, okay, you have a solution. So in particular, if the radius of nanotubes is larger than a critical value that depends from the number of walls in the nanotubes, from the bending stiffness, the surface energy, if the radius is larger than the critical value, you have the cell collapse of the nanotubes. Due to the interaction with the other nanotubes. So if you put some plausible number, this is the bending stiffness of graphene, this is the van der Waals adhesion energy, this is, as I mentioned before, describe a weak coupling between the walls, you get this value for the diameter of the cell collapse of nanotubes. You see, single wall is this, two walls is this, three walls is this. And in the previous image, you have a few double wall nanotube. You see this is reported here. You see, this is the number of walls. You have also a triple wall nanotube. And here you have the state of nanotube, if it's collapsed or not collapsed. Okay. By the way, it's not. I think it's quite. This image is quite clear. But I have taken this table directly from the paper that I mentioned before. So basically, this was not just my interpretation of the image. But I think that the interpretation is simple, so it's not very difficult to understand if an object here collapses or not. In any case, if you apply the theory, you get exactly the same result. Exactly the same. So this means that the very simple equation that I showed you before exactly explain you why this one is not cell collapsed, but this is cell collapsed. And also, you can make prediction on the sliding failure of this nanotube bundle, because now you have these cell collapsed nanotubes. And so you are increasing basically the surface area between the nanotubes. And if you want to predict the strength, okay, of this element against sliding failure, okay, you have to apply fracture mechanics. You can apply fracture mechanics or quantized fracture mechanics. In this case, the result will be the same, because in this case, the crack propagation is metastable. No big difference. You apply classical fracture mechanics. This is an energy bias according to fracture mechanics, and this is the prediction from the bundle strength. If you put some number here, you see that the prediction for the bundle for using single wall nanotube is 48 GPa. For two wall nanotube is 34, three wall is 28. So it's something, in any case, that is completely different with respect to 100 GPa that is assumed, or that is the ideal strength of the material. So we cannot assume that a nanotube bundle has a strength of an ideal nanotube. It's absolutely without sense. And you can also, with the equation, try to understand which is the role on the strength of the cell collapse. So you can make the calculation assuming, from a geometrical point of view, the collapse or the not collapse configuration. And you obtain basically these results. You see that if the nanotube has set collapse, you have an increment in the strength up to 30%. That is not a huge value, but it's something. So the idea is to produce a nanotube bundle with a sufficiently large nanotube in order to activate the set collapse and having a stronger material. And with the same equation, you can also understand that, let's say, dot bond-like configuration of the collapsed nanotube. Of course, you cannot have here a radius tending to zero, because otherwise you have an energy, elastic energy tending to infinity. So you have this configuration, and you can predict the value of the diameter of the lobes here. And if you use the equation with the previous value, you get exactly 1.1 nanometer. This was a prediction made according to finite element simulation.